Joel chapter number 2. Joel chapter number 2.
As you're turning there, I want to take this opportunity to thank God for the opportunity to preach again this evening. Thank God for the opportunity to preach. Thank Him for the call. Just thank Him for this church and where He's placed us and the things He's done for us. And I'm just so thankful for everything God's done and looking forward to what He has in store for us. Joel chapter number 2. I'll give you a second turn there. It's not a very popular book. So, Joel chapter number 2, I'm going to start reading verse number 21. The Bible says, "Fear not, O land. Be glad and rejoice, for the Lord will do great things. Be not afraid, ye beasts of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness do spring, for the tree beareth her fruit, the fig tree and the vine do yield their strength. Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain, and the latter rain in the first month. And the doors shall be full of wheat, and the floors shall be full of wheat, and the fat shall overflow with wine and oil. Now I will restore to you the earth, restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten, the cankerworm, the caterpillar, and the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you. And ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God, and hath dealt wondrously with you, that my people shall never be ashamed. And ye shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God, and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed." Our gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you again for the reading of your word, Lord, and just thank you so much for your word, Lord, that you've sent us, Lord, that we may be able to just open it and read it, Lord, and just that you can speak to us through your word. Ask you just help me, Lord, tonight, what you've laid upon my heart, and ask you just meet with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 The first thing we'll look at is obviously it talks about verse number 21, rejoice. And I just mentioned that song that Caitlin sang, and it talked about who am I. We have plenty to rejoice in, but too often than not, we do too much whining. We spend way too many times, way too much time focused on what we don't have instead of what we do have. And I'm afraid we go through life and we miss the blessings that we have because we're so worried about what we don't have. And we think, well, somebody else has this or somebody else has that, or they got a bigger house or a better car and all those kinds of things. And we take our eyes off of what God has blessed us with. And I've made the comment before, we could all think that we need a better paying job and we need more money. And in my experience, more money brings one thing, more bills. And that's all it does. We have more money, we just think we've got to spend more, and it don't make us happier. You know, it don't help us out any. It just causes us to spend more and more stress upon our life. And instead of rejoicing in the things that we have, we spend way too much time worried about what we don't have. Instead of rejoicing in the fact that we get to come to church, that we have a church that comes to, that we have the opportunity to come in the middle of the week, we complain so many times. We spend too much time complaining about things instead of rejoicing in the fact of what God's done for us, of what God's done. You think about the fact of where those of us that have been here for very long, think about where we came from over there. And, you know, it amazes me each time I walk through there. I still think, Brother Steve, we used to have service in here. You know, we used to sit in there and have service and where people would sit. And it's amazing to me. We should rejoice in the fact of what God's done for us and what He's brought us to. And we see this here in Joel. In these verses, it's going to talk a little bit about the promise of deliverance. And we see them, He's telling them to rejoice, for the Lord will do great things. Are we rejoicing and looking forward to what God's going to do in revival? Or what God may do in camp meeting, or what God's going to do in tonight's service, or in Sunday service, or whatever it may be. And we should come rejoicing in the thought of what God could do. Do we get up on Sunday mornings rejoicing in the fact that God could save somebody to jail, that God could save somebody at Immanuel Baptist Church, that we could see somebody's lost loved one, or we could see somebody's lost children, or wayward children possibly come to church today and get that thing made right? We should rejoice and look forward when we get up to come to God's house of what God's going to do that day. The second thing is we see, and it starts talking about in verse number 25, and he's talking to Israel, and he talks, "I will restore to you the years that the locust hath eaten, the cankerworm, the caterpillar, the palmer worm, my great army which I sent you." We see those things he's talking about that he's going to restore. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time on that, but think about the things that God did for the people here, and what do you see him do? And in verse number 26, and for like, you know, thought about, we see the reward, "And you shall eat in plenty and be satisfied." Why can't, you know, this goes back to the thing, rejoice. Why aren't we satisfied? Why, everything that God has done for us, each of us individually, why are we not still satisfied at times? That song, you know, who am I? What gives us, and this is a pet peeve of mine. I don't know where this comes from. This just popped into my head. And I'm a firm believer. If God placed it in my head, placed it on my heart, I'm going to tell it. I don't know if it's just from driving so much, but it aggravates me to no end as I'm driving down the interstate or driving any place, and you come a place where somebody has to merge. And also, there's other people here that know what I'm about to say. People that won't use their blinkers, that just think they're entitled to just come right on over, and if you don't slow down at times, they're just going to hit you. I'm convinced they're just going to run into you. Where does that sense of entitlement come from? Where does that sense of entitlement come from for us that we just automatically think, well, you know what? This, I am who I am. I should have that. I should get that. You know, you can say that God's blessed me, but you know what? I should have that because of what I do or how hard I work or whatever. We see that God gives us rewards and God does things for us, and we don't rejoice in Him too often, and we're not thankful for Him too often because we feel that sense of entitlement. And if we don't get those things, we want to blame God. Well, why don't God bless me? So-and-so comes to church once every month, and they have this and this, and I'm there every time the doors are open. God don't give me that. God don't do that for me. If we fail to look at the things that God rewards us with and the rewards that He's given us, and if we would think that and quit looking at the things here on earth and realize that the things we do for God, that our reward will be laid up in heaven, and get our eyes off the things here that's going to be destroyed one of these days anyway, we'll be a whole lot happier people. You know, we spend too much time worrying about what we have, what we don't have here on earth, when it's all going to burn up one day anyway. It's not important. You know, we get too worked up over things in this world that just flat out are not important instead of looking forward to what we have in heaven. Sure. The last thing, by way of introduction, verses number 26 and 27. I want to look at those last seven words, I think it is. And my people shall never be ashamed. Are we ashamed today? We see the result here. He's gonna restore these people and give them this reward. And He talks about the deliverance here that they're going to have. It's talking about here in Joel. And He says twice right there, and my people shall never be ashamed. Yeah. We claim at times maybe that we're not ashamed. Then why don't we do more for Him? If we're not ashamed, why do we not tell people? Why are we not willing to just go up and tell people about the Lord? Well, that's just not my way. I just can't we openly talk about anything else. I would dare to mention that, I don't know, throw whatever number you want to out there, a big, big percentage of this state will have no problem walking up to somebody else in this state this week and asking who they think is going to win the ballgame Friday night. Those that are right with God knows who's going to win the game. I thought I'd get Thad to smile. But we have no problem talking about those kind of things. We have no problem talking about our job or walking up and talking about those people. Why do we have such a problem talking about somebody who we claim means more to us than anything? Yeah. Why do we have such a problem talking about that person that we strive to be able to see and spend eternity with in heaven? We should never be ashamed of God. And I'm afraid too many things that go on in this world, some of those things that are going on and some of those things that are being shoved down our throats are because we're ashamed. We don't want to stand up. We don't want to stand up and say, no, that's not right, because we're ashamed. We don't want people to know the stand that we have. We don't want people to know that we're maybe against gay marriage. We don't want people to know that we're against abortion, because what if they won't be our friend? What if they won't do this? What if they won't do that? And we're afraid to stand up because we're ashamed. And it talks about, and my people shall never be ashamed. We shouldn't be ashamed. We should not be ashamed for what God's done for us and what God's going to do for us, and we should be willing to stand for Him. But I'm not going to preach on none of that. Sunday morning, Sister Annette sang in the choir, Send the Rain. Song sang many, many times. And my mind got to thinking, sitting back there in the pew, and all I wrote down at that point in time was rain. And I got to thinking about what Brother Doug preached about a few weeks ago, the sea's not your problem. He preached about heaven sent dew. And then Miss Annette sang that song and the choir sang that song Sunday morning. And I just got to thinking about rain. What about rain? Rain here in Joel, if you go back and study and look up, and you see back in verse number 23, and it talks about the former rain and the latter rain. Those have to do with what I can find. And I always try to say that because, you know, the things that I look up about this, what I can find is the former rain and latter rain has to do with seasons that it would fall in. The former rain kind of dealing more with later in the year, and the latter rain, the beginning of the year, the spring season, so to speak. And I think about the rain, and you think about the rain that we get each year, and what I want to preach on is we need a spring shower. We need when this revival comes and we talk about God send the rain and we need a spring shower in this sense. When I get to thinking about three types of rain that I kind of attribute or I think of rain, one being a thunderstorm. A thunderstorm will leave its mark, but a lot of times it's not good. You know, I made the comment and I got to preaching in the jail a few weeks ago and I don't remember now what I said, and I got to talking about, I think it might have been the message I preached at the jail. You know, it's all fun and games until you wake up in hell. And I got to talking about hell and started to talk about describing hell. And it's not about scaring somebody into salvation. It's about making them realize that they're lost and their need for salvation. And I told them, I'm not trying to scare you. And too many times, that's what a thunderstorm will do. A thunderstorm might leave its mark. When I think of a thunderstorm, there's many thunderstorms that don't necessarily have a lot of rain. Just wind and thunder and lightning and put a scare. And a lot of times, even if it does rain, if you think of, you know, if we go through a drought here, which would be hard to believe at this point in time, but if we go 4, 5, 6 weeks without rain, that we probably will happen in the summer, what's going to happen that thunderstorm rolls through? Everything gets green for a couple days, and then it just goes right back to the way it was because it just don't sustain anything. The second thing I thought of is, and I don't know of any other better way of putting it that I think of, is a gully washer. Just that rain, it just pours down and it just all washes away. Where I lived, next to where I lived, we had a pasture that we would play in that field. We would play softball and stuff. And I never will forget being young and it raining one time so hard, water running off the road. There was a curve in the road and running down through there, and it made a huge dip out there that you'd have to run through then. And that's what a gully washer does. And I thought of in Proverbs chapter 28, verse 3, it says, a poor man that oppresseth the poor is like a sweeping rain which leaveth no food. Just comes in and wipes everything away. But a few things about a spring shower that can help us in as it relates to revival. A few things about a spring shower. You think about a spring shower, first off, and you might not think it smells good, but the first off, a spring shower will smell. We think about the smell of rain in the spring. You know, you go buy candle scents or scents to plug into the wall, and you'll see the things talking about rain. It's in Job chapter 14, verses number 8 and 9. It says, though the root thereof wax old in the earth, and the stalk thereof die in the ground, yet through the scent of water it will bud and bring forth boughs like a plant. Think about that. I've made the comment before that Brother Doug has talked about it. We should just want to smell him. I just want to smell him. I want him to come through here, as Brother Doug talked about. I just want to smell him. And we can smell just like the spring shower will smell. We should desire to have a scent of the Lord as he comes through this place. And it talks about the scent. In Job chapter 14, just the scent of water would make it bud. Who knows what we could do if he could just come through and we could just smell him, how he might show up and meet with us. If we just have that smell that comes through. The second thing, I'm going to slow down and y'all be out here early. You'll be wanting to preach every night. The second thing, and I touched on this a little bit about the thunderstorm, is the spring shower will saturate. You think about, we look at, too many times, and especially if you work outside, you'll look outside and you see that rain when it just rains all day. Just that nice, steady rain that rains all day. It saturates the ground. It just gets it in good and deep and hold so that it can sustain, we'll get to that in a little bit later, what it needs to sustain. We need to be saturated. Not just a quick dose of God to show up and just be gone in a matter of a week. We need to be saturated. We need it to come in and just saturate us and stick. You know, I think about, unfortunately, I don't believe he's here. Brother Philip, when I was writing this down and God was giving me this, my first thing that came to mind was Brother Philip. And I understand completely, we all have different personalities. We're not all going to maybe act like Brother Philip. But that's what we need. We need people to see that we have it down deep. We have it down deep in our bones. We are saturated to the core with what God's done for us. We are saturated and to be able to show out what God's done for us. Not somebody that when they face, the first thing they face, they fall apart like the rest of the world does. We need to be saturated. And you know, when I thought about saturated, I thought about Brother Doug talks about that one of the hardest Sundays to preach is after revival. That especially after a good revival meeting that we've been in and God's met with everybody and everybody's on high and he has to come in and preach on Sunday. So I'm not asking you to pray to this end, but here's my thought. We need to be so saturated. We need God to show up and do something for us. I would love to see Brother Doug not have to preach a single Sunday in the month of April. Just a continuous meeting. If God lays on his heart to preach, God lays it on his heart to preach. But we need revival to break out and something to go on that he has to have other preachers come in, or maybe we just continue, whatever it may be. But not to be a burden to have to preach, because God is just so great and has saturated us so much that it's not a matter of him having to come in and preach the week after revival. It's maybe him coming in and preaching just as the revival continues. But we don't want to think like that, unfortunately. But the spring shower will saturate. And that saturation is what can cause it to spread. You think of it as a spring shower. You know, what is, and I hope this is right. Boy, I hope I didn't mess this up. April showers bring May flowers. Is that right? You think about what those spring showers that we have, and it causes things to bud, and just then how it spreads out. You know, you have to have the bees to take the pollen and the flowers and all that, and we get all those things that those spring showers, as it spreads out. You see the flowers grow. You know, we then go get all the little flowers to give, and we see all those things that happen. And all the things that spring showers go, how it just spreads across. And you think that when those showers come, we just slowly see things starting to get green. We just slowly see things start to spread out. Leaves start to gather on the trees. And you know, those leaves, yes, they're going to fall maybe at some point in time. But I'd much rather look at a tree full of leaves than just a dead old bunch of branches. You know, I look outside in our backyard, and it seems like every other day I look out and I see different buds coming up on our trees, and I keep thinking, please don't frost and kill it. You know, I don't know how that kind of stuff works. Just please don't frost now and just kill all the buds and take that much longer. We like to see those things spread out, and we like to see those things happen and see those things that will spread with those spring showers. And the fourth thing that spring showers will do is sustain growth. 2 Samuel chapter 23 and verse number 4. And he shall be as the light of the morning when the sun riseth, even a morning without clouds, as the tender grass springing out of the earth by clear shining after rain. If we think of the spring shower and we ask God to send the rain and God will saturate us and do those things, it can sustain growth. It can give us those roots that we need to not be a statistic, as I talked about last week, not to be one of those churches that closed, not to be one of those churches that used to have service on Wednesday night, that used to have service on Sunday nights, or even that used to meet. But it can sustain that growth that we need to see revival go on and on and on. And even if it's not a matter of meetings, even if it's not a matter of having some preacher come and preach for a week, but just something that continually grows in the people, that people can say, hey, what's going on out at that church? What's going on out there? As I talked about, as Brother Doug has talked about, that feeling of that need for people when they drive by to pull in and see what's going on. To pull in and see, something's different about when we drive past here. Something's different. Something's caused me to need to pull in and see that it can sustain that growth. As I talked about in 2 Samuel chapter 23 and verse 4. In Acts chapter 14 and verse 17, nevertheless, he left not himself without witness, and that he did good and gave us rain from heaven and fruitful seasons, filling our hearts with food and gladness. Fruitful seasons. Not a fruitful week, not a fruitful Sunday, not a fruitful couple days or couple weeks. Fruitful seasons. We can sustain that growth with with those April showers, if we'll allow God to do a work in our hearts. You know, when we talk about that sustained growth and talk about those kind of things, looking at and reading some things about revivals, I found something it talked about, and this was it. And unfortunately, this is why we need revival. Because when you're studying and you go looking in revivals, most of the stuff you will find is in the 1800s. There's some stuff it talk about the early 1900s, but a lot of stuff you find is 1800s and even before. And one of them it talked about was a revival that broke out. It was in New York, and it was talking about all the people that would meet and their prayer meetings and things that would go on. And they would have 5 separate prayer meetings a day because they could not contain all the people that would come in just one. And in those prayer meetings, it got to the point where businesses would put on their doors, will reopen at the end of prayer meeting. That's what we need. Amen. You know, I made the comment that about praying about coming out to prayer meeting on a Saturday night. We should have, there's no other way to put it, we should have a church house full of people that Saturday night. If we're truly interested in revival, if we truly want to see God saturate us and sustain growth and do something around here, it should be full. Plain and simple. It should be full. You know, but unfortunately, we don't think along those lines. You know, and one of the other revivals that I could read and talk about was talking about in the early 1900s, and it happened just in a little town in Kentucky. You know, there's things that, and I'm by no means am I studied on these enough to know everything about them. But the thing that happened in Kentucky, it talks about is the Second Great Awakening. But revival, awakening, whatever, God showed up and did something for people. And it just started in a little town in Kentucky. We could just be that little town in Kentucky where things start. But I want to read something to you that I found. And look at this, and it talked about historic revivals. But this is something I think that does good with today. And I want to ask you a question as we finish up. It says, across the globe today, there is a growing cry to God for a fresh outpouring of revival power. There are very few live churches in the world that do not have this hope in their hearts and on their prayer agendas. They're saying what they are currently experiencing is so weak and anemic, so shallow and ineffective, that they need a new season of refreshing from the presence of the Lord. They have heard of times in the past when God visited His people and restored their fortunes. They are excited by the possibility of a fresh wind of God's Spirit in the church. Many are developing a holy passion, even a desperation, for God to come down from heaven and establish His kingdom amongst men. They are jealous for His name and His fame. Their appetites have been whetted, and they are spoiled for anything less. But what can we do? What steps can we take? What is an appropriate response to the need this hour? And what does God want us to do? And it goes on and talks about a few other things. Are we that desperate? Can you include yourself in those first two little paragraphs that I read? Can you include yourself in that person that is just desperate to see God do something? We need an April shower because we need God to show up, and we need God to do those things for us. I want to smell Him. I want to know what that smells like. Brother Doug talks about it. If you don't believe him, that's fine. That's your problem. But I want to see what he smells like. I want to know. I've smelled a lot of things. You know, Tina went out and bought a bunch of different fragrances and stuff and plugged up, and there's things that mix now and all kinds of weird names for them throughout the house, and it smells good. I want to know what he smells like. I want to go home and be able to think, you know, this smells good, but it fails in comparison to what he smells like. And we should want Him to saturate us. And you know what? And if He'll saturate us, to allow us to spread. You know, to allow us to go out and spread and go throughout, you know, you talked about all those things that spread, we need to spread. You know, we do so many things in the church and knocking on doors and hanging tracts and mailing things out. But if we would just really get hold of God and see Him come meet with us, we might be amazed of what we might spread. You know, I'm sure... with what Brother Doug went through, I'm sure he don't want another building program. But you know what? I bet that if it's God, that's what God wants, he'd be all for it. What if that's... Why can't we? Because we don't want the rain like that. We want the thunderstorm. We want the rain that comes, that we might have a good week. And you know, who knows, all three of those gentlemen might preach every night, and we might have a good week, and God might really meet with us, and we're okay with that, because that don't mess up our plans. We're okay. We know we can schedule. As Brother Doug taught me, he's told us many months out in advance. So hopefully we've got that scheduled in and we know what we're going to do. And we have our DVR sets, and so we won't miss our TV shows. And we can do things around the house before and after and get everything, as long as that's it. Those 4 or 5 days, that's all we want. Just that little flash in the pan. And in doing that, we won't allow God to saturate us. We won't allow God to sustain that growth in us. You know, we'll let Him come in and just do something for us that week, but we need so much more. Amen. You know, I don't want to call people by name, but there's people, I'm convinced, there are people in this church that we pray for that the only way we're going to see something happen is God's going to have to send revival. He's going to have to send revival. There's too many people that would maybe never darken the door of a church. You know, I try to tell, when I go and preach to the jail, and I try to tell them, say, you know what, you're here. If God didn't have something for us to do, we wouldn't be here. Plain and simple. If God was done with you, you'd be gone. You can't argue that fact with me, I'm sorry. But if God had nothing else for you to do, you wouldn't be here. And I try to tell those people, if the only thing you might do is God's placed you here, possibly to get saved, to see your family get saved. Because if you're from a family, if you're from something that you're now mixed up in something bad and you're in jail, there's a pretty good chance you would never come to Immanuel Baptist Church. But you're here now. Right. And there's a good chance your family might not never come to Immanuel Baptist Church. But you know what? If you get saved and God sees something, do something in your life, they might. Same thing with us. We have people that we pray for wayward children, pray for lost children that we've been praying for a long time. They might not ever darken those doors if we don't have true revival breakout and God sees something different so that they can see something different in us than what they see throughout the world. You know, the world is, you know, as Brother Doug's talked about, you go out on visitation, if you happen to knock on doors that hang in the track, you'll be hard-pressed to find very few people that won't say they're a Christian. That's why you can't get people to come to church, because they look at too many other people's lives and say, well, I'm just as well off as they are. You know, I can hear about all their crazy, wild stories, and they say they're saved and they're going to church and all those kind of things. What do I need to be saved for? That's why we need revival, to see something break out, something different that will saturate us and spread throughout our country, and that we can sustain that growth. You know, as I said, a thunderstorm, we get into the middle of summer and you see that rain come through, and if it pours down rain, you know, it's going to do one of two things typically. One, it's just going to wipe away right there on the top and it's going to be gone. And your grass might green up for a day or two or a week or two. It might cause Brother Randy and Brother Ray come out and have to mow the grass twice that week. But you know what? For week after that, nothing. But it's those nice spring showers, those nice showers that last all day that really sustain the growth. That's when you really see things starting to come up. That's when you really see things start to take shape and see things happen. And we see the beauty of what God created. We see His beauty in the flowers and those things that come up. That's what we need. We need that spring shower. We need that shower to do something different to what we've ever had before. I don't want a week meeting. I'll be honest. You know, and unfortunately, I don't have the vacation time to be able to take off every night. I hope, my prayer is I have to get up and leave every night. That we're still, that the service is going on so great and so wonderful that I have to get up and leave in service at some point. Not to be disruption, I don't want to be. But you know what? That means that God's doing something for us. And I don't want it to be a week. I don't want our pastor to have to get up on that first Sunday after and talk about how hard it is to preach because such a good, I just want it to go on. What do you want? What do you want? Do you want that shower? They sang that song, Send the Rain. Do you want the rain? Or are you just hoping the drought continues? You know, once we hit summertime and it gets to about 95, 100 degrees, a lot of times I'm okay with that drought because I don't have to mow the yard. It makes things so much simpler. You don't have to weed eat. Don't have to do all those things. You know what? If I'm playing golf, my ball goes a whole lot farther when it's dry out there, Brother Brian. Boy, it just keeps rolling. I watched a golf course last week that it was dry and the ball just rolled forever. That's not what we need in our churches. We need God to come in and send the rain and soak us and saturate us to see something different. We took many prayer requests, lost family members, lost children, lost co-workers, lost classmates. Those aren't getting answered without revival. they're just not. Those might not ever get answered if we don't see God show up. So what do you want? Do you want a thunderstorm? Do you want a gully washer? Or do you want God to truly send the rain that can do something different, that if this world goes on another 100 years, I can look up and my grandkids can look up, or great-grandkids, whatever it may be, can look up and they can search on their newest iPad that they may have and look up revival instead of just going back 200 years, then go back 100 and say, you know what? There was that great revival that started right there in Florence, Kentucky in 2014. Look what God did. Is that what we want? Or do we want the drought to continue? Brother Clint, you come, get us on.